Okay.
All right. Yeah, so message queues we're going to talk about. I am not an expert. I just use RabbitMQ for one project of mine and done a little research, so I'm just here to share my knowledge with you guys and can ask questions in whenever you want, and just hopefully I can help you answer them. So I guess, what does a message queue do for you? Like, it allows you to like asynchronously interact with components to do out-of-band work. So like, if you're doing something, I'm always looking at things in the context of a web application, because that's going to be what you're doing is you're processing a request from a client, trying to give them a response quickly. Well, if you're doing something that's has a lot of work to it, or could potentially slow the client down for whatever reason, the client response, then and that information does not like necessarily matter for the client to know about. So like, if you're updating an index in your database, sometimes that might take a long time depending on how big your database is and stuff like that. So you might not need to do that right away, and you can do it afterwards. So you can send that to a message queue, and something else can take care of that for you. Or generating reports, like if you want to generate PDFs or something in the background, if you want to send emails or something like that that could potentially block, something that maybe calls a remote service to do something, because that might be going over the network, and networks can always block a response if it's slow or whatever. So the components of a message queue are, there's a producer, someone who creates the message, a broker. These are generally the components. A broker is like who receives the message and distributes it to a consumer. The consumer just processes it and gives a response to the broker. And then a queue is where messages wait for consumers to consume them. And you can use multiple queues and multiple ways to route messages to different applications and stuff like that. So the different implementations that I know about, AMQP is like a protocol that a lot of these implementations adhere to. I don't think ZeroMQ does, but RabbitMQ and ActiveMQ and others do implement this protocol, and when you implement this, you're supposed to be able to interact with different message queues without having conflicts and stuff. You should be able to use multiple systems together, potentially. So RabbitMQ is kind of like full-featured. You can have persistent queues, so if like a server goes down, your broker goes down, and you start it back up, it'll start back from where it started instead of you losing that data. ZeroMQ, I guess it can have brokers, but out of the box, it's brokerless, and it doesn't have a persistent cache of what you've been working on, so if something goes down, you could lose that data. So if whatever you're doing is very important that you maintain all the data, it might not be the best for you, or you might be doing more work to make it persistent. And ActiveMQ, I don't know a lot about it, but I've heard it's kind of like the middle ground of the two. It's like a little faster than RabbitMQ, but maybe not, doesn't have as many features and stuff. And all of them I found have pretty good documentation, and all of them have very good, or lots of APIs available. Almost every language has multiple libraries to interact with these. And Celery is a kind of a wrapper around RabbitMQ for Python that I use, and it's really nice. You just specify a function as a task, and then you just call that function in a certain way, and it'll automatically queue it in your message queue for you. And you can store the results in various kinds of databases, and you can do cron tab like scheduling, and has management tools that are really nice. It's it's very nice if you just want, if you need some kind of message queue that's really quick and easy. And you don't need like super fast scaling, which I don't know if anybody here is needs to scale to Twitter like magnitude or anything like that anyway. So I, most of the time I think people will be looking at something, at least in our audience, like maybe RabbitMQ or the Apache one, ActiveMQ. So use cases that I thought about is mass mailing. That's what I use it for. We send out like a million emails a day, and usually it's all at once because they all decide to send their emails out at once. And we can usually send them out in like an hour or something like that. And we have like four servers that are consumers of our message queue, and one server is the producer, and it doesn't take long to queue them up. But it's the reason why the mail processing is something that we wanted to put in a queue is because each email is unique and does queries and writes to the database, because we take a record of the data and everything. So it does enough, and when you can put them into little small transactions that are traceable. If there was an error somewhere, say if you're going to just iteratively go through, you know, 100,000 emails and send them one at a time, well, what if there was an SMTP error on one of them? Well, then all of a sudden, you might screw up your whole sending every email, and you might not easily be able to trace that one, whereas you can kind of break it up and easily see where there was a problem with what email, with what user, and stuff like that. Other things, payment processing, you can have some other process kick off payment processing on a website or something. Say, you know, everyone's done it, and they've gone to a page and say, hey, this is processing, wait here. And once it's done, we'll let you know. Indexing data, I told you about in large systems, just simply updating an index is something that sometimes can be a little slow, especially when you want to get the request back to the user. And observing spikes in activity. Because if you think about like maybe cloud management systems, if all of a sudden you have like a lot of, you have to stand up new servers, you have to make changes to servers or whatever. I'm sure it's all done in a queue because you can't all do it at once. It might really slow down things. Anything that are kind of repetitive tasks that can be out of band. Does everyone know what I mean by out of band?
No.
So out of band is something that can be outside of, so say you're currently processing something and there's a task that needs to be done, but it's not necessarily dependent on you finishing the rest of your code block or whatever. You can say, hey, I'll do that later, so that would be out of band from what you're doing right now. And that it can take time to process. That's pretty much what I have. I'm going to demonstrate Python with the Pika library and Celery. Any questions before I get into any demonstrations?
What's the Pika library?
It's just a message queue library for Python. It's just the name of the library.
In the mailing thing that you were talking about, does it send them all out at once or queues them up at one at a time?
It doesn't. So I have four servers, and each server has, I think it's like 13 processes that are handling these. So there's, 50 or so that are doing it at once. Well, 50 at once, I guess.
Okay.
Normally, it goes pretty fast. We also have multiple SMTP servers, or mail servers, I'm sorry. Mail servers that are sending them out to that it goes to multiple levels of direction. So, but yeah, we found that our bottleneck was generating these emails, and if we did them sequentially, we'd have to wait for each one of them to finish to start the next one. Well, this one we can do, 50 at once, and if we wanted to go faster, we could just add another server and we could do more. Could add more CPUs on one of the servers and add more processes. We'd do more. Just as long as our database, at that point, it might be our database server that would slow us down. But it provides an avenue of scale. Like, you can scale in a direction that way. You're not constrained by processor, you know, processor speed or something like that. Any questions? Am I making any sense? Does this seem useful at all?
Yeah.
Okay, I'll show you. It's really pretty simple. I'll just give you an idea of what it entails. Let's get rid of some of these things I've got going on here. Sorry about that. Okay. So, we will start from the beginning here. I think I got some notes. So to start RabbitMQ, it's that easy. And by the way, I think I'm running, and by default it runs like open to everyone on the network. So if you guys are adventurous, you can try sending me a message and seeing how I can handle it. Any of you guys know Python, you could probably follow along and send me a message to try to handle. I think this is my IP. Anybody's interested? Maybe not. Okay, so anyways, I'll show you the receive code using this Pika library, or however you say it. You just connect to the RabbitMQ server and create a queue, or declare a queue to use. And this is the callback. I just say it'll take a little bit of time to handle. And this is all you do for consuming it. It's pretty easy. So that's receive here. So I'm going to run the receive application. It's just going to sit there waiting for stuff to process. So we'll be able to see as things come in. So now if I run send, which does pretty much the same thing, but then queues up 1,000 messages, let's say, you know, test message, whatever number, and then closes the connection. So we can see how this goes, and they're all queued up and getting processed right there. So pretty easy. Allows you to consume them one at a time. If you wanted to do multiple at a time, you'd have to use multiple processes or do multiple threads or whatever to consume multiple parts of the queue at a time. Because this is only going to consume one at a time as it's getting them. But multiple of these programs can connect to the RabbitMQ server to receive them.
So does it wait for? Does it wait to? And then sends it when it has to get the information, then sends it?
So what happens is, so when I sent it here, that's a good question. So I'll turn off the handler, what am I trying to say? I'll turn off, this is the receiver, the consumer. I should have called the consumer. I turn off the consumer, so now, it'll just be queued up in the RabbitMQ server at this point. It should be. So I'll do the send. So I just queued up 1,000. Let's see if I can remember the commands for this. We do RabbitMQ list queues. Yeah, so I have 1,000 in the test queue right now, but nothing's consuming them, so it's just sitting there. But if I start up the receive, it starts consuming them, and now it's done already. See, that's another thing I didn't get into. See, this will say it's done, but the thing is, the consumer can say, I'll grab, 1,000 of them at a time and put them into my own little local queue or something, or whatever. And I didn't actually get into explaining how you define all the variables. variables of how much you can grab at a time and how many you can decide to take at once. But that wasn't a very good example then, because you ended up seeing them all gone right away. But anyways. So what I guess what I just kind of showed you is, you know, things can go down, messages can be in the queue, but something can come back up and still process them, and you can add more, and more can be processed from the queue and stuff like that. Something that's a little bit easier to work with is the celery library I told you about, and this is all you need to do for saying, like, this is a task that I want to be able to do in the queue, or out of band. If I am writing an application, I just want to say, I want to do this stuff later. So I'll turn off that, and I'll turn on, here, I'll check off the notes, make sure I don't do anything wrong. I'll run my celery consumer. In this celery, at least in the way I have it set up, you can see my celery config. This is all it takes. This defines the broker, where I want to store my results. I'm going to store them in a SQLite database, whereas before I wasn't storing my results at all. I was just producing them, or I was just consuming them and discarding the results. So this is going to store it in a SQLite database that I have. And
can you put anything in a message?
Yeah, you can put whatever you want. So celery.
It's totally arbitrary.
Totally arbitrary. You probably want to, actually you probably have base 64 encode your binary data, but.
Okay, so it effectively is a text.
Yeah, it's a text.
It's a text thing.
Yeah.
Okay.
And,
But can you send it to certain users, or for certain clients?
You can, like, that's where it gets into, I didn't talk about it at all, just because I didn't want to. You can define different routing, it's called, how in different queues you can define in different routing which kind of consumers are gonna consume this queue, or which consumers this message is directed for and stuff like that. You can define all that in the message.
So this could be a local queue or it could be a network?
Yeah.
Yeah. Okay. Is it the same either way, or is it just a
It's the same either way. Yeah.
And could it be a dialog box saying, like you know, when Linux is shutting down, it says, you know, it'll broadcast it out saying, shutting down. So, in 20 minutes or so.
I mean, yeah, you can do it however you want. It all just depends on. It depends on your use case and what you're looking to do. It's pretty simple. Like you said, it's just a text.
Is there a size limit?
I don't think so. I don't know. I don't think so.
I mean, there'd be practical issues probably.
Yeah, I mean, I guess there's probably like limits to, you know, you're gonna maybe make it slower because you're gonna put a strain on your network at that point or something like that. But I'm sure you want to keep the messages small because that means they're like fast,
right.
Little transfer.
The whole
data
concept sort of breaks down if you have a 10 gig like message or something.
So, like, if you're doing video encoding, and let's say these are like 10 gig video files, you'd probably want to send in your message in order to do this video with where that video is stored, and then the consumer would be the one that would actually grab the video and do the stuff that.
Or store the video in a database and grab the database. That's the way I see it. Like the way, I'll talk about celery. Celery wraps it all into a really nice, it creates the message and everything for you and maps it to functions in Python. So you don't have to worry, you don't have to understand you don't have to like figure out how I'm going to parse this message or anything like that. You don't deal with that at all. It just does it all for you in the background. And so I'll just do a little bit of So, say we want, I have this tasks, and let's say, and then I'll away. You can see
that I consumed it. Wow, that doesn't look very good though.
It says I got a task and I consumed it in 1 second because I had a delay in there. And I'll do a bunch of them now. The random amount of delay time. You should be able to see them kind of queue up. And I think this one will do like 5 at a time or something like that. That's why you kind of see them go a little bit at once. But this, I'm putting a Python function in the background and processing it and getting the result. And I didn't really have to do anything. Celery kind of packaged it all up for me and made it pretty easy. And I'm pretty sure there's complementary Celery-like packages for other languages too. I don't know off the top of my head what they are, but this is what we use. And it stores the results in a SQLite database. So you can see, at this point it's just storing the, how do I explain it? Like this is the message ID, this is the task ID, this is the status of it. It could say it's started, it's finished, or it's I forget all the different statuses, but there's like 5 different statuses, and this one means it's successfully finished. But if you want, you can take this and celery control result. Get what the actual result is from the task, the function return. It's pretty easy, pretty nice, and kind of useful. Any questions? I think that's pretty much all I was going to go over. So,
so it would just put it into this database here
at
your
right.
That
would be your name. So, like, yeah, okay, I'll show you. And, oops. Here. I just queued one up right there. You get a result of that queue, and it's an async result. So you can see there's much different methods you can do to check and see what you're doing, and you can say what's the status. This one says it's pending because it hasn't started yet, because all these other ones are in the queue before it. So then you can also do is if you can get task ID right here. So what? You could use that to say, hey, this is the task ID for what I'm waiting for to be done. And you can maybe give the user, say, hey, this is the status of your task, but it hasn't finished yet, or whatever. And you could even tell them, you know, you're this number in the queue, potentially, or something like that, if you wanted. So you could, and then you can also, in your program, if you queued up, like, four... I don't have the syntax Swift thing to look at right now, but if you had like 4 different tasks that you just wanted to do at once, you could queue them all up and then say, hey, I want to wait for these 4 tasks to be done before I finish processing. It's kind of just like this. There's a wait command right here, and that will just wait, you know, like pause execution in the program until that thing has finished processing.
Oh, and then it will...
And then it will continue on or whatever, and you can get the results back.
I heard that it... Or when they were talking about ZeroMQ, there's some things that'll just send, and some things that will just receive, and then some that are asynchronous that kind of can say like, "Are you there?" And so, "Yeah, I'm here." Mm-hmm. And so it'll, you know, a lot of potential. I can see why and mostly was used in banks, it sounded like.
Yeah, I think it was ZeroMQ is used for like NASDAQ trading and stuff like that. It's high frequency trading, like something that you need to do really fast and stuff.
Yeah.
That's what I've heard.
Yeah, because I can see in that application you're talking about, we're sending out tons of emails. Well, you know, like if you have one mail server, you just need to multi-thread the thing, you know, to whatever's reasonable, you know, you could have done that some other way, but the thing is that you're trying to do it over many servers.
Well, yeah,
I can see that that's a fairly straightforward solution.
Yeah. Well, and it gets more complicated with that, too. We had to have multiple email servers in addition and couldn't send out too fast because you'll get blocked if you send too many emails too fast, also. So there's a lot of things where you have to distribute it into multiple servers that have different IPs and different
setups. The receiving end start blocking you because you're sending emails too fast.
Right.
Yeah, the email world of emails is insanity. Yeah. It's not exactly the most efficient protocol in the whole wide world. I mean, it's efficient in a sense, but it doesn't get data out fast.
Mm-hmm.
And, plus there's all the spam issues. All that kind of thing.
It's encrypted.
Huh?
Not encrypted either.
Most likely not. Although, that's one thing I don't know about. The thing is, because I know, like, I've got my, or set up with, you know, the TLS type stuff, you know, so I've got a key and stuff like that. And if I watch it, it looks like with a fair percentage of mail servers that it does make a, you know, from the mail server to the mail server, not always, of course, but a fair percentage of the time, not that I've exactly analyzed to verify that it truly is encrypted, but it looks like it does. It really should be, particularly with all the snoops out there, like government, amongst other things.
Is there a way, I don't know the proper terminology, but to do, have a consumer be preferred over another consumer?
The priority queues and stuff like that, yeah, we do that. Because I do that in just the mailing application that we use, because when we're sending out a ton of emails, we don't, if someone does like a subscription reminder request, we want that email to go up before everything else, because we don't want the person waiting. We don't want him to go to the end of a mail queue or anything like that. So yeah, you can have different queues that have different consumers that are free and stuff like that. You can't necessarily put it in front of the queue, but at least not that I know of. But you just have different queues, and then you have different consumers that only do that queue that might be free more often or whatever.
I'm saying in a scenario, let's say you have two consumers, and you have a bunch of data, and you process what their similarities in these data. So this one server already ran one for this one data set, so it had a cache, so then it would pull another one with that same data rather than having another one, because it had to load all that.
Yeah. Maybe I don't quite understand, but I think what you might want to do is have one queue up another task after it's done or something. Or you're saying like they're both similar tasks at that point, right? They both need the same type of data almost.
Well, what I'm saying is, so let's say in order to process this task, it has to pull in a ton of data.
Yeah.
Pulls it all in, puts it in memory, processes it, and it's done. Now it goes to pull another one.
You don't want to have to pull it twice. So
right. At
that point, I think you probably want to do something like beaker caching, or I'm sorry, I'm using only, I think that's only in Python. And just like memcache implementations to cache your result that you get. And you can have memcache servers that you're pulling the data from and stuff that you're storing from. So I think that's probably where you want to go with that. Does that kind of make sense?
Yeah.
Is it, you don't like the solution?
Well, I mean, we use a different kind of software.
Yeah, and I know you use Microsoft, but you can still use your own cache.
Well,
no,
you can use something that isn't even Microsoft, but they call it a fabric.
Okay.
And I forgot, I don't work on the project, so I forgot the terminology, but there's a way. So basically, this consumer already has pulled in customer data, and this one doesn't, and a request comes in for that customer, it'll know to send it to the one that already has it versus the other.
Hmm. So you're saying you have different, okay, you have different like application servers and one way to process something, so instead of having a shared cache, they're just sending the, they're redirecting requests to whoever would have had it, so you have to keep track of who has done what instead of just caching the data. So you save memory at the cost of having to manage those interactions, I guess.
Right.
That's, I don't think that this can do anything like that, but that's interesting. Oh, come on.
Nothing on the screen.
I think that's pretty green and black.
Okay, yeah.
I don't know, any other questions?
Well, it can send anything, any kind of data, like video, voice, or voice cues, or whatever.
Right, but if it's got to be text, there becomes some real efficiency issues if you're going to do
binary
data.
Like,
but
yeah.
It can,
I mean,
but
perhaps it does do binary, I don't know, but it looked to me like it was just text data that it was going, that it was just like, you know, doing, you know, like you could almost tell that and send the message that way, kind of thing, you know, easy type text data.
Because this has a lot, you know, a lot of potential, like you said you're using it for, because, I mean, you said, like, oh, yeah, this is kind of cool, I could use it for sending out mass mailing instead of, like, spending an all-day job doing this, which you probably did before, right? It took me quite a while.
Well, we just had scaling issues with power application. I wasn't going to do this message queuing first. There's a lot in what produces our message. There's enough queries to the database, because there's specific things for every message for that user that it's directed to. We can't just send one message out to, you know,
so each individual message is specialized for that individual, or you know, specific to that individual. This means, let's say I bought something and it might say, like, refer it to that.
Mm-hmm.
There's a lot of potential there. It's at least for like any, like eBay or whatever. You can send like specific individual messages or emails or whatever.
I'm sure that's what all the big guys do for their stuff. It has to be, because to have a responsive website, you have to queue so much of the stuff in the background and distribute it to your servers to be able to.
Because I was on Newegg or Tiger Direct, and they sent me, and I was looking at some processors, eight-core processor, and I got an email saying, you were looking at these processors. And I'm like, yeah, I was.
Amazon does that a lot, too.
And it's like, but something similar to that, if using a message, a RabbitMQ, or some kind of zero-MQ to do that specifically. I thought it was pretty cool to do that, but it was kind of, you know, a little bit too much where I was going.
Turn off your cookies and stuff. Log out. Start raising the prices on you. That's what airlines do, right? If you look at something too much,
when you're thinking of buying a domain name or something like that, you don't want to ponder it too long.
Someone else might grab it.
Well, with some of these places where they provide the lookup service, I think they literally will pick it up and then will try to sell it to you for extra, you know, because I don't know if they stop that. I would think you know.
I've had domains where I looked them up and then the next day they're bought.
I think I'd go to the text mode who, you know,
searches for what people
who is.
Are looking for.
Yeah, I don't know.
I think I'd just use the text mode who is thing and just use that instead of using theirs because...
Well, actually, I use the browser and I just go there and there's no server response. I'm like, oh, that might be open. And I create
oh,
a
you
list.
Did it that way.
I create a list of ones that might be open because there's no response. And then I
well, you do the who
figure
is.
Out if it's...
You know, I mean, I haven't done that for like 15, 20 years is the last time I bought a domain name.
But you
Type
who is and then...
Just the domain.
That's a, just a Linux or Unix domain.
Right.
I also use big. That's a unique list.
Well, if you do the who is, it's actually going into the registry data. It will typically give you a certain amount of information as to who actually has it. So, are we done with our...
I think so, yeah.
Okay.
I don't think anybody else has questions. I can kind of